Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning and welcome. The weather is now warm and spring is for sure. Spring is here with us.
Amen.
So it's fantastic. And I am pleased and happy to hear that ED is doing better and she is planning to come next Sunday. We will have a Good Friday service this coming Friday. Welcome, welcome. This coming Friday, April 15th, at 7 p.m. In my office, where we have fellowship. So I ask all of you to come. This is not every Friday, but only this Friday, we are going to have a Good Friday service. Please join us for this solemn time of worship as we contemplate the suffering and crucifixion of our Savior, Jesus Christ. This is a very special occasion. I understand that Seoul Union Church did not have this.
It's true.
Okay, so maybe we are going to have a new tradition. Number three, we will take a special Easter offering next Sunday in addition to the regular Sunday offering. So the offering envelope is provided in the bulletin. So you use that to give a special Easter offering next Sunday. Number four, please use the bulletin as our church's flyer to invite people to church. I am asking you to carry your Bible with you around, especially when you come to church. This is very important. Without the Bible, the church does not exist. Without Bible, there is no faith. Bible is the center of our Christian life, and it's the pillar of our faith. So, Bible is important. Number six, everyone is encouraged to invite expats to worship with us next Sunday, Easter. You know, please invite your friends, especially, you know, foreigners or international people next Sunday and always. When we have about 50 people here, then we are going to march to take back our sanctuary in Yanghuajin. I am praying that we are going to have some very, very important and effective work to go back to Yanghuajin. But we need enough people to make an exclamation mark in the Korean Christian society. So please think about this and invite expats and also some Koreans who can speak English fluently to our church. Number seven, our service is available via Zoom. With special thanks to Seokwon and Sam for doing this work. Number eight, please contact me if you have any prayer requests. If there's a private thing, I'll pray privately. Nobody will know. But if you want to ask the church to pray for you or for special prayer item, then we'll put on the bulletin so everybody can pray. Everybody can pray for you. As usual, after every "Oh, I forgot your name." No, Josh. You're Josh. But your wife's name is very difficult. All right. Welcome. Okay. So, after the service, every week we are having fellowship. So, please join, unless you have some urgent matter. It's wonderful to fellowship together. Alright, and prayer requests. We've been praying for Edie, but we have good news that Edie is doing better and she's going to join us next Sunday.
Hallelujah.
Yes. During Lent, please pray for three members of the congregation daily. And then there's one more. In this insert, on the front side is the hymns, the three hymns. So the back side is the Holy Week Scripture Reading Guide. It has from Monday until next Sunday, every day, if there's the Bible verses are listed here. So you, as a family, or with your friend, every day pray that portion, read that portion and pray together. And that will enhance your faith. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Who's sitting in front of him? Yeah.
Peter Kim.
Peter, did I see you before?
I don't think so.
All right. Peter, thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Let's welcome Peter. Maybe you know him, but it's first time for me. Wonderful. I will ask Jack to lead us for the procession.
Good morning, everyone. It's great to see you here. If we were in the sanctuary, we'd probably have some young people with us. And normally the children of the congregation are the ones that bring the palm branches forward. But since we do not have the little ones, guess who's going to do it? It's going to be you. All right. So this is how we're going to work it. I want you to file to the outside aisle, okay, and just get one behind the other. The palm branches are actually there right underneath the clock, okay? That's what they look like. They're not real palm branches, they're plastic ones, which I had the joy of washing. What I'm going to ask you to do, based on the number of people here, we easily have one for each of you. But those of you towards the end, if you see some extra ones, please pick them up because I don't want any left back there. Okay? And this is how we're going to work it. You're going to first person, meaning the last person in the row, just file right where you see Chungsu down that aisle. File inwards, and Chungsu, will you just hand them? Hand them a branch, all right? And then you're going to walk up here and lay the palm branches at the foot of the cross, all right? After you've done that, please go back to your seat using the outside aisle, all right?
Hosanna.
Hosanna.
thank you, Dad, that we must continue our tradition, whatever good tradition our church has or has been conducting in the past, we must to continue to do it. This is one of the things. Usually, what do you do with the palm branches after the Palm Sunday? The church, they keep it until next year. In the beginning, in the day, on the day of Ash Sunday, that's the beginning of the Lent, they burn it and they use the ash to put cross on their forehead. That's why it's called the Ash Sunday. Ash Wednesday. So if we burn this plastic palm branches next year, we'll be in trouble. So we are not going to do that. But we'll continue to use this plastic branches until Jesus comes back to us. I have an extra announcement. The animals are having horrible troubles with our masks. When you throw this away, this loop here is giving them troubles. Birds, they catch the two legs like that, and then they cannot fly. Animals, they cut their necks. So when you throw this away, don't just throw away. Take this off, like that, and then throw away so that no animal will be suffering because of us. And then, of course, you wear a new mask, pretty mask. All right? Okay, that's good. Let's have a responsible reading here. Ready? Lift up your heads, O gates.
And be lifted up, O ancient waters.
The King of glory may come in.
This time just divide between men and women. So, who is this King of glory?
The Lord strong and mighty.
The Lord mighty in battle.
Lift up your heads, O gates.
And lift them up, O ancient waters.
That the King of glory may come in.
Who is this King?
Love covers over a multitude of sins.
Today I want to take special time to pray a prayer that my brother sent me on behalf of the Ukraine, but also it applies to any nation that is under oppression. So as I pray this prayer, if there are other countries that you have been actively praying for, please feel free to pray on their behalf and use this prayer. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, today as we remember your triumphal entry into Jerusalem, we ask for your triumphal entry into Soul Union Church and into our hearts and minds. We rejoice that you're Lord of all, and the day is coming when every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord. Today we feel compelled to intercede on behalf of the Ukraine and other nations whose leaders only seek power to control and oppress your children. We come before you today in a continual declaration of peace in the name of Jesus over the war taking place. We boldly ask you to establish and strengthen the bond of peace across the body of Christ in both Russia and Ukraine, to draw near to all the followers of Jesus scattered across these nations, and to bind them together in supernatural love that moves with the power of the gospel. Let your kingdom break forth in demonstrations of peace in ways that confound the ways of sin and darkness and death and evil. We pray for you to intervene in the hearts and minds of the leaders of Russia, to turn from their invasion and to seek peace.
Amen.
We pray for the leaders of Ukraine to protect and preserve them from harm and to fill them with such a spirit of travail and prayer that it touches heaven and changes the course of life on earth for their country. We pray for the leaders of governments around the world for wisdom and courage for facing of this hour. We rebuke the spirit of fear that would cower in the face of evil rather than confront it. We cry out for an awakening of the church around the world to realize both our responsibility and our power to intervene and exercise our kingdom authority for such a time as this. Amen. We pray for the many relief agencies at work on behalf of the Ukrainian people. We speak Jesus into them now in the power of your spirit, courage, perseverance, love, and joy in the face of utter desolation. We put upon them the full armor of God so that they may stand. Release miracles through doctors and nurses as they rescue the perishing and care for the dying. We pray you would leave in the wake of this evil, human-made disaster and all its desolation, the seeds of a great awakening and the rising up. Awaken your church now in all places to imagine and conceive of this great awakening now in the place of prayer on earth as it is in heaven. Finally and most urgently, we pray for the millions of children who are crying and afraid, many of them who have lost their parents and are alone. Those that are wondering if they will ever see their fathers again, longing for the safety of their homes, anxious about their next meal, afraid for their very survival. Father, agreeing with the psalmist's prayer for the ages, we cry out, let God arise, let his enemies be scattered, let those who also hate him flee before him. We ask these things, declaring the things that are not yet as though they were already, believing in your power to do beyond all we ask or even imagine, through your power at work within us, and trusting in the strong name of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen, amen. And amen.
Amen.
Will you bow with me and repeat the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us.
us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Let's sing More Love to Thee, O Christ, and we will give our offering. Sometimes singing, praising God, is more important than the sermon, because God does not need a sermon, you know. And God, all He needs is our recognition that He is our God.
Amen.
And He is our Savior.
Amen.
So we do that through our praise, through our singing. Therefore, singing fervently, singing powerfully is very important. And also saying amen or hallelujah is also the part of praising Him.
Yes.
Praise in the Bible does not mean always singing. It always means that you recognize Him, He's God. But singing is the best way to do it. So that's why you do it. So we should memorize all of this and sing, you know, joyfully, but we do not have that kind of ability. But we have Sarah. So let's sing once more this song, More Love to Thee, O Christ. Now I'm almost in tears. Let's sing loudly.
Oh,
we have beautiful sunshine and blooming cherries all around us. Thank you for giving us this season. And also, we thank you for giving us better season in our life. Pandemic was severe, but we somehow overcame. And we are still going to survive and win. As you enter the city of Jerusalem with the victory, we will live victoriously even in this difficult situation. And we hear good news that it is doing better. We hope to see her next Sunday. Help her to have good health continually. Lord, Seoul Union Church is a special church in Korea. Help us to live up to that name. Help us to regain our place in Yanghwa-jin. Let people know that Seoul Union Church continues. Today, as we come to church, we didn't come empty-handed. We prepared a gift, offering for you, for your kingdom. Bless us, bless our hands, bless our families, so that we'll continue to serve you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Gloria is going to read Matthew 21, verse 1 through 17.
Matthew chapter 21, verse 1 to 17. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage and the mountain of Olives, Jesus sent to his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with a colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. Say to daughter Zion, "See, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt on the foal of a donkey." The disciples went indeed as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that were ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from the Nazareth in Galilee." Jesus entered the temple courts and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doubles. "It is written," he said to them, "My house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making a den of robbers." The blind and the lame came to him at the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things he did, and the children shouting in the temple courts, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they were indignant. "Do you hear what these children are saying?" they asked him. "Yes," replied Jesus. "Have you never read from the lips of children and infants, 'Your Lord has called forth your praise'?" And he left them and went out of the city to Bethany, where he spent the night. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Good reading. I forgot to ask you to stand up and it was a time of Bible reading, so remember that, please. Automatically, let's stand up and Bible is read. Great. I'd like to thank Jack for bringing this heavy cross. How did you pull it up?
With help.
With help.
With help.
It's heavy.
Yes, it is.
Yes. Thank you very much. And bulletin, do you like it?
Yes.
Yes, Yummy made this. This looks perfect to me. I like it. Our bulletin better than any church's bulletin in this city. Hallelujah. Good. So thanks to Yummy and thanks to Seogwon. Where is Sam today? He couldn't come today, right? Yeah. Alternative.
Yeah.
So they both are working on Zoom streaming. So wonderful. How many are now, how many entered the Zoom?
Sam.
Sam? Okay, good. It's better to come here, so it's okay. Great. The title of my sermon today is a little bit annoying because it's a simple question. Do you know Jesus? I'm sure everyone knows Jesus here. But I put this title to challenge you. Do you really know Jesus? Let's look at it. You know that last Sunday, Jesus was where? He was in the village called. You remember the village? Name of the village? Bethany. You remember?
Yeah.
Bethany? Jesus came from the north, from Jenin to Jericho, and then up on the Judean wilderness, and then he entered Bethany. This is the most strange way of preaching. Okay. So let's look at some pictures. Next. Okay. Jesus began between Galilee and Samaria. The Bible does not say that. The modern tradition says Jesus entered a village called Jenin. So Jenin is here. There he cured 10 lepers. Remember? Mm-hmm. Remember that? And then he came this way through the Jordan Valley. You know, this is a very hot valley. Now the temperature here rose up to 20. But if you go here, it will be over 40. Very hot. And he walked down and then he entered Jericho. We know now there are two Jerichos. One is from the time of Old Testament, another one is from the time of New Testament time. And then in Jericho, he cured Bartimaeus, remember, the blind man?
Mm-hmm.
And then he saved who?
Zacchaeus.
Remember that?
Yes. Yes.
All right, respond. And then he left the New Jericho, and then he went up to Bethany. Where is Bethany? Bethany on the eastern slope of the Mount of Olives. Next. So, I don't know if you can see this. That he left Jericho, he came to this New Testament Jericho here, and then he climbed up on this desert, Judean desert, and then came to Bethany. That was last week's sermon.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's a Bethphage, but he will pass through Bethphage today. And then he entered the city of Jerusalem. Next. Now, we see this picture once more. This is the area where the King Herod had his temple complex, and some commoners lived around here. This is a New Testament Jericho. And that mountain peak is a fortress. King Herod made a fortress up there and named it with his mother's name, Kypros. So when I, now Israel opened up, so we'll go to Israel someday. Maybe this year, who knows? And Jack is going to Israel without me.
The plans are up in the air with Edie.
Not yet.
We just don't know how Edie's going
to Let's go together. Okay. All right, next. So from there, there's a Roman road going up. There is, on that side, a paved road. But this is the ancient road going up this way. Next. Remember this road. The Romans, of course, they used the local power, local manpower, local labor power to make, to carve the steps in the bedrocks. Next. So this is the shape of the wilderness these days. Next. And then in Bethany, there is a tomb called the Tomb of Lazarus. It's still there. It's still there. This picture is old. This picture was taken about a century ago, but it's still there. Next. Then, so this is Bethany. Now, in my sermon today, he's going to come out and he will pass through this mountain, Mount of Olives. It's a very high mountain. And then it will go down. This is the valley, this is the Garden of Gethsemane, and then he will enter Jerusalem, the city of Jerusalem. This map is the map of the time of Jesus in Jerusalem. So this is the temple, and this is the city. And there is, the city was expanded like that, and then later, not today, later, the tomb of Jesus is here, outside of the wall. But if you go to Israel now, you will see this tomb is inside of the wall. So don't be confused. Next. Now when Jesus came out, he told his disciples, you hear me, right? You hear me without microphone. So Jesus, he spoke to the, I don't know how many people, without microphone. You know, it's a small, tiny room, and we use microphone. Is it working on? Ah, you know. Silly. My voice is enough, I suppose. Okay. They are the Palestinian donkeys. I think they are very pathetic animals. Next. That's the colt. Jesus told his disciples to go to Bethphage and bring a donkey and its baby. So it must be the mother donkey and the baby, colt. It's cute. Every baby is cute. Next.
Oh.
And grind anything. Next. The Palestinians, they till the land with the donkeys or ox. Cultivate the land with animals. Some areas are still doing that. Next. The donkeys and mules, they are pack animals. They carry heavy things. Even now, this is made of iron to load more stuff on this poor animal. You know, how cruel that is. But I never saw donkey complaining. They do it. Next. But how about this?
Oh, man.
This small donkey carries how many boxes here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 10, 60 or 70 boxes. And without complaining, it's doing it. Like this. Next. Up until the beginning of the 20th century, the people rode on donkeys. Now they drive cars, but this noble man is riding on a donkey. The man is much bigger than the donkey usually. Next. And then people came out and they had these palm branches. The palm branches are the symbol to honor a king or the general or the conqueror. And I've been wondering why this is that kind of symbol. Look at the shape of it. It's an extension of your hand. You want to wave your king, but this is an extension or exaggeration of your waving act. That's my interpretation. So, this is beautiful branches. Next. And the tree grows like a 50 feet, 15 meters high. This tree is very grandeur, very imposing. It's a beautiful tree. Next. And dates, the sweet dates are from this tree. Next. This grove is near the Dead Sea, the palm trees. Traditionally, palm trees grow in the Jordan Valley, from Galilee down to Jericho, on both sides of the valley. And Jericho is called the City of Palms. Next. And then people, they took off their coats and threw in front of Jesus. He was riding a donkey. Look at Jesus is much bigger than the animal. If he was riding a horse, the horse would be bigger than Jesus. But here, this animal, I don't know which one he was riding. He was riding on the mother donkey or on the colt. In the Old Testament, it sounds like he was riding on a colt. If that's the case, the baby donkey was having trouble with this big guy Jesus on him. And they threw their cloaks, modern day coats, in front of Jesus. Why? Because that was like carpet. Or as kings and the rulers, they walk on carpet. So on the road, they don't have carpets, so they take off their clothes, put on the road like a carpet. Next. So Jesus entered Jerusalem, the city of Jerusalem. Next. Modern day, it's today in Israel, from Mount of Olives, people go down. This picture is blurred because I know so much. But there is this Jerusalem city, and that's the Valley Kidron, and people carry these large branches. Not plastic, real palm branches, and walk down the western slope of Mount of Olives. Next. And they go up into the city of Jerusalem. Next. They're going next. And that's the city wall, modern day city wall. This is called the Lion's Gate. So they enter this way. There are some people sitting up there. The picture. I used to sit here when I was young, in the 30s. I was up here sitting. So, but that time is gone. I cannot do that anymore. Okay, next. All right. This is the city of Jerusalem in the time of Jesus. So that's Temple Mount. This is the residential quarter, and that's an extension of the residential quarter. Someday I'll explain this in detail, but today let's stop here. Yeah. In this text, number one, first, Jesus came out and he sat on a donkey. Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9, Zechariah in the Old Testament said, "Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, the righteous and the victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." So in this text, it says Jesus was sitting on a donkey, on a colt, on a baby donkey. Why? Matthew Henry said, "When Christ would appear in his glory, It is in his meekness.
Let me talk on this. I'm busy.
When we have our own building, I'll have all the buttons here. So I can press this button and this will go up. Press button and the lights will come. But we'll wait. Oh, it went down. Winning the army. So Christ will come in meekness, meekness, not in his majesty. So here, Jesus entering Jerusalem, he was riding on a donkey, not on a horse. Of course, horse was available at that time. Donkeys and mules were pack animals in the ancient Near East. They were also used to transport people. It was a lowly and humble act for a king or prince to ride a donkey or a mule. King David was a warrior. He rode horses in the battlefield, but he also owned a mule, not a donkey, but a mule for peacetime riding. First King 1:33 says, David told his people, "Take your Lord's servants with you and have Solomon, my son, mount my own mule and take him down to Gihon." At Gihon Spring, they crowned Solomon as the next king. When Solomon went down there to become a king, he didn't ride horse, he rode a mule. So in Israel, kings have a tradition. It's a humble act. It's more friendly to the people if you ride mule or donkey, lowly animal, than a horse. If you ride a horse, you're imposing, and it's more threatening than friendly. Number two, then a large crowd put their coats on the road in front of Jesus. This large crowd, a lot of people, I don't know how many, but maybe 100, they came. Some came from Galilee with Jesus. Some joined him from Jenin. Some people formed a group in Galilee, in Jericho, I mean. And then eventually in Bethany. Because when they saw the miracle of Bartimaeus and the miracle of Lazarus, they began to follow Jesus. So they're a large crowd. I'm sure it's more than we can imagine, maybe 1,000. Even today, if you know that something happened like that, a large crowd will follow that person. Then the people, they took off their coat and spread it on the road in front of Jesus. This is a method to pay homage to a king. If we see that in the Old Testament, in 2 Kings chapter 9, verse 13, when Jehu was crowned, it says like this, they quickly took their coats and spread them under him on the bare steps. It was in the building, there's a steps. Then they blew the trumpet and shouted, "Jehu is the king!" So Jehu stepped on the coats of the people like a carpet. In the Greek mythology, the Trojan War, the war in Troy, Agamemnon, he entered Mycenae, the palace in Mycenae, and he walked on the carpet. So this carpet and cloak, they are the same thing. And then people had these palm branches from the trees. The palm trees grew in the Jordan Valley and also on the hills and the mountains in Israel at that time. I already told you that it grows very high, tall, and if you read Deborah's story, Deborah's story, Judges chapter 4, verse 9, Deborah, the female judge, was doing her work under a palm tree between the place called Ramah and Bethel. Ramah and Bethel are the villages or towns on top of the Judean hills, above about 950 meters above the sea level. So it's a high area. And so you can tell the palm trees are growing up on the mountains. She was doing her job under that palm tree for 40 years. So people began to call it the palm of Deborah. So that appears in Judges chapter 4, verse 9. Verse 5. In ancient times, palm branches symbolized goodness, well-being, grandeur, steadfastness, and victory. If you remember that King Solomon carved the palm trees on the walls of the temple, the Jerusalem temple. The reference is 1 Kings chapter 6, verse 29. Palm branches were regarded in the Bible as tokens of joy and triumph, and were customarily used on festival occasions. You can see the Leviticus 23:40 and Nehemiah 8:15. In Leviticus 23, verse 40, says, in the Feast of Tabernacles, you go out and bring the palm branches and celebrate and rejoice for 7 days. And then Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 15 says, when you have festivals and you go out in the hill country, okay, so there's another, again, hill country, and you bring the palms and to make the temporary shelters. Kings and the conquerors were welcomed with the palm branches being strewn before them. In Greece, the sportsman as the symbol of victory. I don't have the picture of the coin, the Roman coin made in AD 71. The Roman coin, someday I'll show you the picture, that shows that the city of Jerusalem was destroyed by the Roman army, and all the Jews were crying. So in the coin, there is a palm tree, and triumphantly standing there, but the Jews were crying, you know. So the palm trees are a symbol, palm branches were a symbol of victory. In Revelation chapter 7, verse 9, Revelation says, in the final victory, all the nations, all the people, every language, they will come in front of the Lord, and they will wave the palm branches in front of Jesus. Wow. Yeah. So this Palm Sunday is a preface, the beginning of that final victory in Revelation chapter 7. Number 4, the crowd shouted, Hosanna! Hosanna is a Hosanna in Hebrew, that means a save. It's a, grammatically, it's asking. It is ordering. save us. So they thought that Jesus was the king to save them from the Roman occupation. At that time, Israel was occupied by the Roman ruler. They shouted Hosanna in the highest heaven. They thought that Jesus was the man to save them. They misunderstood. So finally, Jesus entered the city of Jerusalem. Now something strange happened. Something very strange. When Jesus entered the city of Jerusalem with a large crowd, and the entire city of Jerusalem was stirred, and people in the city said, "What's going on? Who's that guy? Who is that? Why there are so many people following him? What's happening?" They didn't know who Jesus was. I don't understand it. This is very odd. Because at that time, by that time, Jesus was known to the nation of Israel. But the people in Jerusalem didn't know Jesus. This is very strange. This time when I was preparing this sermon, suddenly it occurred to me. I never knew that. The people outside of the city of Jerusalem, they knew who Jesus was. Remember when the disciples went to somebody and they took the colt and the donkey. And the guy said, "What's going on? Why are you taking my donkey?" They said, "Oh, the Lord is going to use it." The man said, they didn't say, "Okay, take it." The man knew who Jesus was. People threw their clothes in front of him. People brought the branches from the palm trees and hailed Jesus. They welcomed Jesus. But in the city of Jerusalem, the center city of Israel, they didn't know who Jesus was. That was very strange. Lesson number one. People gave up for the triumphal entry of Jesus. Some people gave up their coats. Some people gave up their tree branches. And somebody gave up a donkey and a colt. They gave up to prepare the entry, triumphal entry of Jesus into the city of Jerusalem. What are you going to give up for Jesus? Are you ready to give up something for the triumphal entry of Jesus into your heart? Do you want to give up something for Jesus for the sake of the whole Soviet Union Church? Are you ready to give up something for the sake of Jesus victory in your life? You cannot have a secular life and a spiritual life together. You have to give up something. Number two, the crowds misunderstood who Jesus was. They thought that Jesus was a king to save Israel from the Roman occupation. Hosanna! Save! They shouted. But Jesus was not a political savior. This is very obvious from the things that Jesus said and taught after he entered Jerusalem. He was the Messiah. Messiah is Christ in Greek. Messiah is a Hebrew. Greek, in Greek, it's Christ. Jesus, not the present. Jesus is Messiah. Messiah. Remember that. He was and is a spiritual savior. He was there to free them, free the people in Israel from the satanic occupation of individuals. Why are you following Jesus today? Do you know that satanic power is real and active in people's lives and in society? Jack prayed the people in Ukraine. What's happening there? The devil is working very hard these days in all over the world. Russia is doing the devilish work. North Korea is an evil country. In this country, evil things are happening. Satan is very busy. Jesus called Satan the ruler of this world. John 14:30. 1 Peter 5:8 says, "Your enemy, the devil, roams around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour." Do you know that Satan is roaming around you to devour you, to make problems in your family, to have you thrown into hell? That's why the Lord's Prayer says, "Deliver us from evil." Do you know Jesus? Do you know why Jesus is needed in your life? Think about it. Number three, it was strange, as I said, that the people in the city of Jerusalem did not know Jesus. They asked, "Who is Jesus? Who is he?" The people who came from villages answered them, "He is the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." Why did the villagers and the citizens meaning the people in the city, have such different information about the identity of Jesus? Which group of people do you belong to? I know you follow Jesus. I know you come to church. But the group who knows, are you belonging to the group who knows who Jesus is? Or do you belong to the group that did not know who Jesus is? There are millions of people, even in Korea and in the world, who attend the churches, and yet they still do not understand who Jesus is, because they never experienced the saving power of Jesus or life-transforming power of Jesus. And I am praying that the Seoul Union Church people will experience Jesus, will meet Jesus, and my sermons will gear up to that.
Amen.
What do you need to know Jesus deeper? The reflection question. There is on the insert, on the back side, there is a Holy Week spiritual reading guide. This is a very important piece of paper. The questions in this guide for this week are meant to help you seriously consider how to honestly answer this question. So, don't throw this away. Take it home and read it with your family, with your friends. And today is Palm Sunday, the triumphal entry of Jesus into the city of Jerusalem. And I pray that Jesus will enter your heart triumphantly. Welcome him and give up something to welcome him into your hearts, into Seoul Union Church. Let's pray. Father, thank you for sending Jesus into the city of Jerusalem, into the Seoul Union Church, into our lives. We humbly kneel in front of you and ask you to govern our lives and our families and our societies. We come to church every Sunday. But much more important thing is that we know Jesus and we obey him. Today, we honor your son's triumphal entry into the city of Jerusalem. But we also want welcome Jesus into our hearts, and we ask Jesus to reside in our church continually.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord. Amen. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
We'll have communion service.
Whoa.
This is a busy week. Here, there's a small card, and if you don't have a pen, there's a pen, and the chance will distribute this card. Why did Jesus come? Why did he have to die? Do you believe Jesus came for you? Do you believe that Jesus died for your sins? Think about the sin you committed. And I'm not asking you to write on this paper, but write your name. Don't write the sins you committed, but write your name. But think about the sin you committed, then ask Jesus to forgive you and to save you. And write your name, and then as when you come to take cup and bread, put your name, the card here, into this slot here, so that the Lord knows your intention and your prayer. Okay? So take a card and write your name, and think about your wrongdoings. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is..." And help us to be sorry about what we did in the past. And let us shout to your throne to save us from our sins, so that we can gladly participate in your communion service. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Before we start, I'd like to remind you, you know this, how to open this. You have to open very slightly, and there is bread on the top part, and there are two plastic pieces. Very thin piece, you open it, and there is the bread. And then there's another lid you take off to open the wine or grape juice. So be careful. There are, you open twice, okay? You have to open this twice. The communion supper instituted by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is a sacrament which proclaims his life, his sufferings, his sacrificial death, and the resurrection, and the hope of his coming again. It shows forth the Lord's death until his return. The supper is a means of grace in which Christ is present by the Holy Spirit. It is to be received in reverent appreciation and gratefulness for the work of Christ. All those who are truly repentant, forsaking their sins and believing in Christ for salvation, are invited to participate in the death and the resurrection of Christ. We come to the table that we may be renewed in life and salvation and be made one by the Spirit. In unity with the Church, we confess our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And we pray. Holy God, we gather at this your table in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who by your Spirit was anointed to preach good news to the poor, proclaim release to the captives, set at liberty those who are oppressed. Christ healed the sick, fed the hungry, ate with the sinners, and established the new covenant for forgiveness of sins. We live in the hope of his coming again. And so we gather as the body of Christ to offer ourselves to you in praise and thanksgiving. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these your gifts. Make them by the power of your Spirit to be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one in Christ, one with each other, and one in the ministry of Christ to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory. In the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Would everyone please come forward to receive the elements as we did it last time. Please line up in this center aisle and come, and Chang will give you the bread and cup. Maybe five people one time. Let's do it all together at one time. Please come. All of you, please come through the center aisle. Yes. And stand in two lines or three lines. Jesus Christ, broken for you, preserve your blameless. Jesus, want to everlasting life, eat this in remembrance that Christ died for you, and be thankful. So let's take the bread. To sin again. We should not participate in the communion service every Sunday after sinning at home in the society. We must live a cleansed life. Now we'll take the cup, the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, shed for you. Preserve your blameless until everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ died for you, and be thankful. Cancels the blood of Jesus in your life. Drink it, be thankful, and do not sin again. As you finish drinking the cup, put your card on the cross. It's a symbol that Jesus took away your sin. You are a new person now. You are new in Jesus. And you may return to your sin.
Sinful world, and thank you for coming to save us. We thank you that you gave us your body and blood to live a cleansed life.
Amen.
Help us to live a life. Help us to live not to sin, to stay away from sin. Lead us not into temptation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Thank you. Let's stand and sing. because he lives.